2018 CMLS Chair-Elect Chris Carrillo and CEO of Metro MLS and founding partner of the Wave Group, Marilyn Wilson.
Good afternoon, everyone. Oh, hey, Chris, what's going on? It's 4:30 in the afternoon, and we're here to talk about governance. Who's excited?
Woo-hoo!
All right, that's a better response than, hey, what's going on? Good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
Yeah, okay. That's yours.
It's all me, all right.
It's all you.
All right, cool. All right, well, thanks, everybody, for hanging around for this, and thanks for many of you that participated in the survey. This is just the early top line of the Governance Excellence Survey that many of you completed. There's going to be a full-on report that all the members will be able to download coming shortly, but I just want to give you a quick update on it. So first, there were about 129 MLSs represented, so it's a really good cross-section, which is great. Again, thanks for all of you for doing that. So the first thing that we looked at is, you know, what's the makeup of what goes on out there? So the first thing, probably not surprising to many of you, is that about 3/4 of the MLSs are owned by one single association. And I thought, interestingly, 1 in 10 of the ones that answered the survey are owned by brokers. I think that may be a little higher than what some people might think.
Mm-hmm.
And the governance, in many cases, is determined by some sort of broker criteria, whether that be geography or the size of the brokerage or things like that. So there's a good amount of brokerage coverage in this. And about 3/4 of MLSs have their own board of directors. So that means still a quarter of MLSs are run by a committee. Some people like that idea and some don't, but it's interesting to see many people have moved over from a committee to a full-on board of directors over the last couple of years. In fact, 1/3 of the people that answered the survey have changed their governance in the past 5 years. So that was really interesting to find out why. And the single biggest way that they changed was by moving from a committee to a board of directors. So I think a lot of people are recognizing running an MLS is very, very different than running an association, and you need people that are dedicated specifically to that with different skills and sure and different training, many of which of you are here today to do that. Also, we're seeing a lot of people that are starting to go down to a smaller board of directors. We just worked with one group that actually had 85 people on their board and now have 10. So they can move a lot faster with 10 people in the room than they can with 85. It's very interesting. Of course, there's a lot of room for consolidation. And in fact, there were 2 announced just this week. And you know there's many more of those. And many of you may be in the works of those. And then also, there was a significant number of people that added an executive committee. Probably, again, for the same idea of how can we make this a little bit more nimble, have a smaller group of people that can think through things and make this whole process move more, you know, more fluidly. So a really interesting, I think, where you see a recognition that we've got to find ways to be more nimble and to address a lot of the things that have been talked about today. So then we also asked the question about, you know, you as the MLS executive, what is it that you're focusing on? And there were a variety of factors. The ones that really came through very strongly was trying to be strategic, looking at outside influences, and administrative. So there's kind of this blend, and I'm sure the challenge, right? You know, Chris, as an administrator and an executive, how do you keep the ball moving forward and yet still worry about where the ball is going at the same time? Well, interestingly, there was less focus on things like customer centricity, consumer centricity, and innovation. And again, I think we've talked a lot about that today, that these are the kinds of things to truly make our MLSs strong for the long haul. We've got to really get closer to what our customers are looking for, not only listen to them, but importantly respond and lead them through things that they may be challenged with. And then really have the guts, and that's really what it is, guts and leadership, to be able to try some new things, right? It's always scary to be the first one to do something or even to be the second or third if it hasn't been done in your market before. But that's really what it takes today. And it doesn't necessarily mean reinventing the whole company, but it may be trying things, you know, testing things, maybe with a small group of members, things like that. So then last we asked all of you, what are the things that you think need to change? And how do you want to evolve your leadership and your organizations and your governance over time? So number one by far was we need to be more nimble and more decisive. And I was just in a meeting earlier today, we were talking about that, is where, you know, can we lock arms and can we move? It's when we bounce things up and down. Let's go to the committee. Let's talk about it. Now let's bounce it back. That's where we get ourselves in trouble. And that happens a lot. It's just the nature of the beast. Being more strategic and really understanding what that means and being like out further and being strategic, right? It's not just what's happening tomorrow, but what are we doing to prepare ourselves for 5 years from now, or even in some cases 5 minutes from now? Things are changing so fast. Expanding the role of fueling data-dependent technologies, and especially things that brokers need from us, right? They're asking for new things, they're thinking about new things, and how do we evolve our role to make sure that we're enabling all of that without leveling the playing field, which is always a fine balance, of course. How do we look at broader collaborations? And there's some great examples of that. You know, Chris is a good example himself, you and Armless, right? They're not even close to one another, yet they're doing some really cool stuff. So you're seeing MLSs across the country collaborate, people locally, nationally, even internationally, there's some stuff happening, which is really neat. More diverse representation on the board, and that doesn't necessarily mean demographic, but it can mean that too, but also things like outside directors, people that may have a finance background or a security background or a marketing background or things that can really help MLSs to take it to the next level. And then this one I thought was very interesting. There was a lot of comments about how do we think more like technology companies and less like associations? So how do we really make ourselves into a company that, you know, that makes decisions, that listens to its customers, that's adapting constantly, that's iterating constantly, that's sort of using the whole agile concept to keep moving forward? So these were your suggestions. So Chris, you've seen the survey. What are the feedback that you saw so far, the things that you observed?
Right. So the first thing is there's no such thing as one size fits all, right? You could have two MLSs, each excellent organizations, very strong financially, and the ability to deliver services and communicate their value to their members. They could be next to each other, they could be apart, and they could be governed completely different, each healthy. So I think the purpose of this survey is to try to glean what are some of the best practices within the industry. At the conclusion of this, before the end of this year, as a member benefit, CMLS will actually take the copious amounts of information that we receive from the survey into a small executive summary. This will empower every MLS executive to come in, and I think warrants a conversation. To take this document then, go back into your own board meeting and just go through them. If there are 11 takeaways, if there are 10 takeaways, this is an opportunity to say, you know what? We think we do 7 of these pretty well, but we're very different on the 3. And you know what? We're comfortable with that. But let's at least take the opportunity to discuss what are the 3 differences. Maybe there's a better way to do it. Sometimes it's human nature to get stuck in this, well, we've always done it this way approach, myself included. So it's always good to go back, take a look at the temperature of what's happening within the industry with all the massive change that's been happening and to say, maybe there's a better way for us to do it, right?
Gotcha. So Everyone in this room is a leader, or they wouldn't be here. And they're not only a leader, they're a passionate leader, or they wouldn't be here. What should they be thinking about to prepare themselves? If nothing else today, you probably are scared that, wow, there is so much going on. How do I keep up? What can they do as individuals to think about how do they be stronger leaders?
Yeah, so one of the items that really jumped out at me in the survey was the high percentage for the executives surveyed who saw themselves more as managing the day-to-day activities of an MLS rather than engaging the industry as a leader. And really, what's that difference? It's really the difference between being a CEO and a COO. Are you managing your departments well? You probably are. But are you engaged in the industry? Can I actually go and point to any number of initiatives, whether it be MLS-led, vendor-led? What are the policy changes coming from the National Association of Realtors? And perhaps Council of MLS has something to say about that. Are you engaged as a leader and bringing that information back to your boardroom and formulating your own opinions and responses to that? And I think for the leaders in this room, do you have a seat at the table? Do you have the ability to voice your concern and your input into that process? And I think that's the one thing that really jumped out at me. So many of us really call ourselves very capable managers, but we must force ourselves to not just be managers, but to engage as industry leaders. And there's a lot that I could say on that, but I think fundamentally, if you're going to be an MLS executive, be an MLS executive. Go, and your board puts so much trust in you. They invest in your time. They should listen to your opinion. Engage in the industry.
Yeah, that's good advice. It's sometimes hard to do that. We all get stuck in the weeds sometimes, but it's really important. So how do you help? So let's say that you've done that. You found a way you're going to be more strategic. You carve out some time to really do more thinking and less administrative work. How do you prepare your board to do the same thing with you? So everybody's moving, and you're tapping into all that brain power that's sitting at the room.
You must always, so as a CEO, you don't just go in with an executive summary in mind. You must also have the ability to read your group. I have to be able to read this group. If I'm putting you to sleep over there, then I know I have to change my tone. I have to know how to discuss and communicate with you. Some folks, some of my volunteer leaders, they really enjoy an executive summary. They want me to send them an email. That's fine. Sometimes I have to take them out to lunch, maybe have a cocktail with them and say, hey, this is what's going on. Okay? It's all about how you can communicate with your leadership, though. And I think once you have the ability to actually go in and communicate and really explain what's happening, you then have to go in and actually define what your role is. And that has to be fundamental and has to be right away, especially as we see the transition in the industry where we're still evolving. Everybody was once an MLS committee. Then they became an MLS board, which is what? You separate ownership from governance. Whether you're in a regional situation or whether you're only owned by one realtor association, that part doesn't change. And once you do, what is the role of the chief executive? What am I allowed to do without getting in trouble? Can I sign a check? Can I not sign a check? Can I engage in conversation? Can I engage in travel? What is the role of the board of directors? Do they, as my past chairman, Dave Schmidt, would say, as a board, I never want us to show up to a meeting and say, I'm making decisions on the number of hole punches in a board packet. Okay, that's just a waste of everybody's time. Am I showing up more as a strategic bumper, making sure that the MLS strategically is going down the road that we all think as brokers that they should? And then the inner sanctum or the sanctum sanctorum, the executive committee, do you have a well-defined executive committee that can actually be nimble to make quick decisions in the event that you must, as an organization, to at least vet issues and then offer them back as recommendations to the board? I think those are the things that help a modern MLS continue to hum and evolve.
So one of the other things that you guys suggested was the idea of becoming more customer-centric, more broker-centric. How do you do that? That's like a nice buzzword. We all talk about that. What does that mean in reality? How do you do it?
So the vast majority of my board of directors, they are, in fact, broker owners. That's not to say that agents don't have a role in other board of directors, and I'm not going to be that guy that says, again, everything has to fit this one model. But I think allowing the majority of your decision makers to be brokers means that you're going to, by default, think strategically. And once you do that, there are important roles for everybody to play. Whether you're an MLS participant or whether you're going to be an MLS subscriber, I utilize MLS subscribers. We run surveys, benchmark surveys. We use them in user groups, focus groups. We know who wants to go and actually hammer new technology, and we know who says, I don't touch the technology a lot, but you know what? I'm really concerned with this off-market listing policy that the MLS is looking at. And so it's make sure it goes back to communication. Are you communicating with the proper stakeholders in your marketplace to make sure that the MLS is effective and is doing what it should be doing?
Great. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
More to come on this.